Good morning. Please open your Bibles to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. If you don't have a Bible, we have Bibles for you at the welcome desk. Maybe not right now, but maybe next time you come in, we have Bibles for you. Mark chapter 2, for those of you who might be visiting, we are in a series through the Gospel of Mark titled Jesus, Servant and Savior. And the title comes from the key verse, which is Mark 10:45, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. And we come to chapter 2, and we're talking about Jesus healing the paralytic. And last week, our own Chris Cloud preached the end of chapter 1 and reminded us that Jesus is the hero of the story. Amen? That doesn't change, so I'm going to give you the answer already. For this passage today, Jesus is the hero of the story. And last week, Chris told us that Jesus came to make us clean in the healing of the leper, and that's how chapter 1 ends. But when he went out and began to talk freely about it and to spread the news so that Jesus could no longer openly enter a town but was out in desolate places and people were coming to him from every quarter. So think about what happened in that story. The leper was in desolate places. Jesus heals him, and now Jesus is in desolate places. Do you see what Jesus does? Jesus changes places with us. That's what Jesus does. He changes the places with the leper. And we know that because he will be gone for a long time, at least a few days, because that's how chapter 2 starts. And when he returned to Capernaum after some days. So Jesus is gone because he can't go anywhere because the crowd is curious to see him. Please remember, when you read the Gospel of Mark, the crowds are never a good thing. The crowds only get into the way of Jesus' ministry. They're never help to Jesus' ministry. Numbers don't necessarily, big numbers are not necessarily a good thing. Growth in the body can be cancer. Growth in the body can be swelling. It's not always a good thing. And in the Gospel of Mark, remember, crowds are not a good thing. And it's the same thing in chapter 2. Crowds get into the way of ministry. They're not actually helping with a ministry. But also chapter 2 starts a series of five conflicts that Jesus has with the religious leaders of the day. This is the conflict number 1. And for the next few Sundays, we will see all five. So chapter 2 introduces five conflicts that Jesus has with the religious leaders of the day. Today, basically, they will ask Jesus, "Jesus, who do you think you are?" And we are told that Jesus comes back and he was at home. Notice it doesn't say whose home. Why? Because probably everybody knows by now that the home is Peter's house. Peter's house becomes the headquarters of Jesus' ministry when he is in Capernaum. Remember, he is not from Capernaum, he is from Nazareth, but he spends a lot of time around the Sea of Galilee in Capernaum. Verse 2, and many were gathered together, so there was no more room, not even at the door, and he was preaching the word to them. Notice, please, he doesn't talk politics. He doesn't talk about self-help ideas. No, he preaches the word to them. And at that time, what was the word? The Old Testament. That's the word that they had at the time. Jesus is preaching to them from the Old Testament. And we also need to follow that today. When we preach from here, we need to preach the word of God. Amen? That's why Jesus came. Mark 1:14. Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God, saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." That's the gospel message. Repent and believe. Why? Because Jesus came to save. That's what we're going to learn in this passage. Jesus came to forgive sinners. He doesn't, again, preach some, you know, Dr. Phil, feel good about yourself, philosophical mumbo jumbo. No, he preaches the word to them. And all of a sudden, the text says that he came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. This is kind of how a house looked like in the first century. A house in Israel usually had two stories. The first level was where you had a stable. Actually, animals were there. Then you had a courtyard, and then you had the kitchen. The kitchen was in the first level. And in the second level, you usually had an exterior stairwell, or you could have something inside as well. You can have a stairway or a ladder in which you would go to sleep. So you would not sleep in the first level, you'd always sleep in the second level. Remember the story Jesus says about that judge, who some people come to him, hey, give us some bread in the middle of the night. Remember that? He says, I cannot come because I'm in bed with my people, with my family. Because why? Everybody was in the second floor. This guy is asking him to go down and give him bread. So it actually brings light to the stories of the Bible. So in this story, these four men are bringing this paralytic to Jesus, and they're going to lower him down all the way in that courtyard where probably Jesus was teaching the crowds. So all the way down, and again, it was not as hard to go through the roof as you'd be going through this roof, and I'll explain in a little bit. But the first thing I want us to see is the action of the four men. They came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. We are not told if the paralytic was their friend. We are not told if the paralytic was their family member. We are actually not even told their names. We don't know who they are. Why not? Who's the most important person? Who's the hero? Jesus is the hero. Jesus matters. That's what the important part is. But it is remarkable that these anonymous men are bringing this friend of theirs to Jesus because they know that Jesus can heal him. The first point of application for us, my dear brothers and sisters, this morning is, do we know anybody who needs Jesus today? And if we do, we need to be like these four men to bring that person to Jesus. And as I'm speaking this morning, I want you to think about one or two people in your life that you need to bring to Jesus. And to start praying for them, and then start thinking about how you're going to engage them in conversation. Remember, people don't like presentations, they like conversations. So they will talk to you, and you need to start thinking about that. And notice, please, the teamwork. All four of them are needed. And the same thing goes with us. Maybe someone will share the gospel with them. Someone will pray for them. Someone, if they're in need, will take a meal to them or will give them a coat if they're cold in the winter. This is important teamwork. We also learned that it's important who you hang around with, isn't it? Who's in your close group of friends that if you have a problem brings you to Jesus? Remember, there are only two types of people in this world, basement people and elevator people. Basement people will always drag you down. Elevator people will always lift you up. And that's what these four men are. They're elevator people. They're bringing him to Jesus, their friend to Jesus, because Jesus can heal him. And we know they believe that. Who you hang around with is important. Who are the people around you? Are they bringing you to Jesus? Are they bringing you closer to Jesus? Or are they driving you farther away from him? You have to think who you hang out with. These four men are bringing the man to Jesus. But notice, please, their creativity. It's not just that their action is important, their creativity. When they could not get him near because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him. And when they had made an opening, they laid down the bed on which the paralytic lay. See, there's no room at the door. Remember, the crowds are in the way. Remember, the crowds are not a good thing. They're a bad thing. They're in the way. And they have to find a way to get him in. They cannot get him through the window. This is a a house, actually a first century house in Katsrin, Israel. This is a window. A window was a very small opening. You couldn't fit a person through a window. So that's why they're not taking him through the window. So what's the other option? The other option is the roof. Now notice the roof is not like this. It was basically beams. Did I touch it again? I touched it in the first service and everything went wrong. And I promised I'm not going to do it, but okay, it didn't blow up this time. Thank you. So you have the beams, and in between beams you had mud, you had grain, you had other things that would stick together, and sometimes even tiles on top. But it would be fairly easy to take those things apart and lower the paralytic through in between the beams. And that's what they did. And I want us to see their creativity. And I want us to understand that as well today. Don't let anybody tell you there's only one way to preach. Don't let anybody tell you there's only one way to sing. Don't let anybody tell you there's only one way to dress when you go to church. Be creative. Be creative. Don't let anybody tell you that there's only one way to preach. Some people say, well, I like verse by verse. Listen, I prefer verse by verse, and I prefer going through books. But nowhere in the Bible will you see that it says that's the only way to preach. I love the hymns. I grew up with Beethoven and Bach and How Great Thou Art. But I don't want us to sing just the whole hymns. I want us to sing some of these newer songs. This last one that we sang is one of my new favorites. Not I, but through Christ in me. That's one of my favorite songs, and it's fairly new. Don't let anybody tell you there's only one way to dress. You know, Phil got the little pocket square. Did you see that? I got to give me some of that. I don't know where I get those. But listen, you know what? Wear what's in your closet. I'm going to wear what's in my closet. You should wear what's in your closet. We should not make each other dress like, you know, some of you are dressing up like some bear mauled you on the way to church. You know, all the, you know, the jeans, you know what I'm talking about? Oh, yeah. That's okay. Listen, nobody will check at the door how you're dressed. And in heaven, definitely nobody will check how you were dressed when you went to church. These men are creative. Not only are they creative, but they're persevere. They persevere. Look what the Bible says about them. When they could not get him because of the crowd, they removed the roof above him, and when they had made an opening, they laid down the bed on which the paralytic lay. If plan A doesn't work, we're going to go to plan B. If plan B doesn't work, we're going to go to plan C. But you know, notice, please, they persevere. They keep going. You can imagine probably some of the doors say, hey, you guys, there's no room. Stay, you know, stay in line. You know, there's other people who want to see Jesus. It's okay. They move on to the next. And when they find the roof, say, hey, we're going to get him down through the roof. They persevere. I'm not a betting man, but this is when four of a kind beat a full house. Oh, let me make a note. Congregation knows poker. Okay. All right. One such persevering man was George Mueller. I want to tell you about George. I love church history because we learn about the great men and women of faith. George Mueller was a persevering man like that. He was born in Germany, lived in England in the 19th century, and he is known for taking care of more than 100,000 orphans. Do you know how he started? With 50 cents. With 50 cents, that's how he started. But he persevered until he raised $7 million for those orphans. He was a man who persevered because he had a calling from God to take care of orphans. But he was also an evangelist at heart, and he had five friends that were not believers, and he said, I'm going to pray for them every day until they become believers. Five friends. I only asked you to think about two. It says, after many months, one of them came to the Lord. 10 years later, two others were converted. The fourth one came to Christ 25 years after he started praying for them. And the fifth one turned his life to Christ after George Mueller died. But that's a man who does not give up. Do not give up on people. Even if you might say, and from a human perspective, that person will never come to Christ. And I agree, from a human perspective, they might be gone, but not from God's perspective. Be like these men, be four of a kind, where you don't give up, where you're creative and you persevere. Some people tell me, I visited that church and I didn't like it. And I asked them, how long did you go to that church? Oh yeah, we've been there one Sunday. Listen, if you want to make a decision about a church, how about be there for a year, get involved, serve, and then tell me if that's the church for you or not. Some people tell me, oh yeah, I got this job, it was great, I quit my job. How long did you give it a try? 2 months. You see, we live in a society where we're not taught to persevere. If it's not happening like that, it's not good. No. That's not what we see in Scripture. In Scripture, we see people who persevere and keep going at it. Someone said, we Christians need to be like postage stamps. Not square. Postage stamps stick to one thing until they get there. I like that. Well, some of you don't even know what a postage stamp is. Young people, ask your grandparents, okay? You know, growing up, I loved to, I grew up in Romania. There was not much to do, you know, there was no TV, no video games. So when I got bored, I read the Bible. I know it sounds bad, yeah. I read the Bible a lot. And then I would take the hymnal and play the hymns from the hymnal. And as I was playing, I discovered this very talented person named Anon. You know, it said Anon composed the song. And I thought, man, this person is very talented. They wrote a lot of songs. I found out later that Anon stands for anonymous. In other words, we do not know who composed the music to a lot of great hymns such as "Oh, for a thousand songs to sing. Bless the Lord, O my soul. Fairest Lord Jesus, just a closer walk with thee." We don't know who wrote the text to such great hymns as "Praise him, all ye little children. Come thou, almighty King, away in a manger, and have you any room for Jesus?" And yet, they did great things in the kingdom of God. I love that these four men, we don't know what their names are. They're not important. Why? Jesus is the hero of the story. And we need to point people to Jesus. We need to persevere like this, these anonymous men. In 1980, the NFL inducted four people into the Hall of Fame. Some were quarterbacks, some were running backs, but the strangest one was there was a center who got into the Hall of Fame. Now, those of you who know football, you know what a center does? Is the guy who just snaps the ball and blocks. That's all he does. Do you know? You probably don't know names of center backs, right? You know the quarterbacks, you know the running backs. But Jim Otto was inducted in the Hall of Fame in 1980. Why? Because all he did was snap the ball and blocked. And it seems to me that that's what we need in the kingdom of God. Sinners who do the little things, but without them, the quarterback would go down, right? I think when we get to heaven, we'll find a lot of Jim Ottos from the kingdom of God. They were not the great quarterbacks. They were not the great running backs. In your church would be people who are behind the scenes. You don't even know who they are, but they're doing the work. And if they don't do their work, this doesn't work. It seems to me that that's what the kind of people God wants, the sinners, who just snap the ball and block. The little things. You show up to church and you serve donuts or whatever you do, you teach. I'm grateful for Chris who preached last week. Chris has a gift, and the gift of teaching, and the sign of a healthy church is to allow people who have a gift to use that gift. That's the sign of a healthy church. We have to be creative and we need to be persevering. I'm convinced that the great work in ministry is not done by the great pastors that you see on TV, but the anonymous people you don't see. Those who cook for the stranger, the anonymous widow who helps the needy, who faithfully all they do is snap the ball and block in the kingdom of God. Their motto is, I want to be nobody to tell anybody about somebody. Wouldn't it be great if that's our motto, if that would be our motto? I want to be nobody to tell anybody about somebody. And the title of my sermon comes from verse 5. And when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralytic, my son, your sins are forgiven. See, Jesus sees the action, and he also sees the faith behind the action. Remember what James writes. What good is it, my brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have the works? Can that faith save him? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled without giving them the things needed for the body, what good is that? So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead. And I love what Jesus does here. He gives the paralytic something he wanted and more. He heals him and he gives him forgiveness of sin. Isn't that like Jesus? Always gives us more. My son, your sins are forgiven. And everybody was happy, right? Wrong. Look in verses 6 and 7. Now some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, why does this man speak like that? He is blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? As one scholar puts it, what began as a heartwarming healing has suddenly become a perilous confrontation over religious authority. See, the scribes were good theologians. They knew only God can forgive sin. Exodus 34 says this. The Lord, a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness, keeping steadfast love for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression. God is the only one who forgives. Psalm 103:3, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquity. The scribes are very good at theology, but they're very bad at math. They cannot add two and two together and say, if he can forgive sins, he must be God. That's right. That should have been the conclusion. Instead, they are accusing Jesus of blasphemy. And Leviticus 24:16 says that if you are accused of blasphemy, if you're convicted of blasphemy, that is a sin punishable by death. Verse 18, immediately Jesus, perceiving in his spirit that they thus questioned within themselves, said to them, why do you question these things in your heart? Which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, rise up, take up your bed, and walk? By the way, which one do you think is easier? Think about it. It's easier to say your sins are forgiven because you cannot see anything right away. Not verifiable right away. But that you may know, and that's the question. Who is Jesus? That's the question. But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. This man goes home healed and saved because four anonymous men believe that Jesus can heal him. They were creative and they were persevering. Be creative. What's the expression? There are many ways to skin a cat. Is that? Why would you want to skin a cat? Or as one of my friends says it, there are more ways to kill a cat rather than choking it with butter. Think about that. Why would you waste so much butter? Verse 12, and he rose immediately and picked up his bed and went out before them all, so that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw anything like this. The last question I want to ask of ourselves, my dear brothers and sisters, are we still amazed at what Jesus does? Or have we read the Bible so much and everything is so, we've heard this before. It does nothing to us. A friend of mine says, sometimes the greatest knowledge, the greatest obstacle to the knowledge of the Bible is the knowledge of the Bible. We think we know it. We've heard it before, right? And I pray that God will give us that sense of amazement again, that Jesus can still does great things, can still do great things. He can still save. You've heard it last week. He can make the unclean clean. Remember, Jesus didn't come to make bad people good. He came to make dead people alive. And that's what he does in today's story. Jesus is still the hero. And Jesus forgives sin. The question is Jesus your Savior? And for those of us who are saved, do we bring our friends, our family to Jesus? I hope that we are still amazed about what Jesus does. Take a look at this video and ask yourself, am I still amazed at what Jesus is doing today?
Stand in wonder once again. Your grace still amazes me. Your love is still a mystery each day. Still amazes me. It's deep.
Let's stand together and sing about this Jesus. Dear Father, I pray that you'll bring to us back the sense of awe and wonder and amazement of who you are and what you are doing through Jesus. I pray that today will be the day of salvation for those who have not yet accepted him, and they will surrender their life to you, the one who makes clean, the one who makes alive, the one who can forgive sins. And for those of us who are forgiven, I pray that we will be men and women who will bring our friends and family to Jesus. Teach us what it means to be creative and what it means to be persevering. And help us to spread the good news of the gospel, not just today, but every day. In Christ's name I pray, amen. Please be seated.